In this movie, you'll be seeing what all are the career options in front-end VLSI and what all you need to start learning to start your career in front-end VLSI domain. So before going into the lecture, so if you like the video, please subscribe us and also visit our website at systemvilogacademy.com to find more Systemverilog courses and training programs. Here is a simplified diagram showing all the process in designing and manufacturing an IC. It involves architecture specification, RTL design, functional verification, synthesis and physical design, IC fabrication, and post-silicon validation. If you are not familiar with these steps and process, I would recommend you to watch our 30-minute video titles, IC Design Process, A Beginner's Overview to VLSI Technology, which is given in the I button and also in the description below. So out of this process, the first three processes are called as front-end VLSI design part or the pre-silicon VLSI design part, and other processes are usually called as back-end VLSI design process. In this video, you'll be seeing only about front-end VLSI career options and what are technologies and languages you need to start learning to start your career in front-end VLSI domain. Before going into the details of architecture specification, RTL design and functional verification, we need to understand that when a complex IC is designed, it will be divided into different subunits and sub-blocks. So this is to ease the process of architecturing, design and verification at different hierarchy. Also, it is impossible to design the complex IC as a single standalone design. And thus, all these three front-end VLSI process, that is architecturing, design and verification, will be performed at multiple unit levels, sometimes at multiple cluster level and at top level as well. This is a representative image showing your top level unit could be divided into multiple standalone units and multiple standalone subunits. Here the units A, B, C, D, E are standalone units. There are three clusters in it, which are block X, Y and Z, and there are different subunits in each of these three clusters. Together, all these clusters and units will form your top level design. The first part is architecture specification. In this phase, the product features are defined. So the features are defined based on the requirements of the market, and after deciding the features or gathering what all features need to go into a particular product, they will be converted into requirements which need to be implemented in RTL design and verified in functional verification. This is done by the architecturing team, and before passing down the requirements to the design and verification team, they will model the requirements in a high-level abstraction model so that they will be able to analyze the performance and other matrices of the requirements and check whether these requirements will be matching with the market requirements, and also they will be checking about the feasibility of the product. Once the project requirement has been fixed, they will pass down the requirements to the design and verification team, and they will start on implementing and verifying these requirements. The next phase is RTL design. In this phase, the design engineers will be converting these requirements into actual RTL implementation, and they will be writing the RTL code in some hardware description language. So in a hardware description language, the design engineers will be writing the requirements in a high-level abstraction manner, and later these will be converted into a low-level transistor-based diagram based on a process called synthesis. Typically, there will be one design engineer per unit, and the task of the design engineer is to write the RTL code based on the project requirements or the product requirements. Before start coding the design in a hardware description language, the design engineers need to write the design specification of the unit. The design specification will tell the microarchitecturing details of the unit. There it will be defining how the unit is implemented in a more detailed manner. Say for example, if you are designing an arithmetic and logical unit, here you will see what all functional blocks need to be present in the ALU and how the ALU need to be architectured, what all are the external interfaces of the ALU, what all are the protocol that this ALU will be able to communicate with other units in the design. Therefore, the RTL designers will be first writing the design specification, and then they will be writing the RTL code or the HTL code. Apart from the design specification writing and RTL coding, the design engineers will also be doing bug fixes, debug supports, integration support, and also they will be modifying the design based on the feedback from the physical design team. You can write the same functionality in many different ways in an RTL code, but it is very important to keep in mind that while writing RTL code in a larger design, It has to be optimized for power, performance and other matrices, so that finally when this IC is produced, it is coming with good area, power and performance matrices. Therefore, to some extent, the design engineers need to be aware of the physical design process as well. The next phase is verification. The purpose of verifying the IC is to make sure that there are no or minimal number of bugs in an actual manufactured IC, and also it is very expensive to find some issues and bugs in an actual IC or even after starting the backend process. Therefore, a verification engineer needs to find out all the possible bugs and issues that is possibly present in a RTL design or even in an architecture specification. Unlike the functionality of the design engineer, the verification functionality could be present at many hierarchies. The verification engineer can be working at a unit level or sometimes at cluster level or a multi-unit level and at top level of the design as well. Or even a verification engineer could be working at integration process where they will be integrating different IPs or different designs together to form the final SoC. Thus, the verification engineer could be present at unit level, multi-unit level, top level of the design, and at system level or SoC level. Before starting verification of any design, the verification engineer need to plan their task and document it in a document called test plan. Every test bench consists of three components: the stimulus component, the checker component, and the coverage component. In general, stimulus is the input that you are driving into your design under test or DUT, and the checker component will check what is coming in the output when you drive inputs into your design. And the coverage component of your test bench is used to measure the quality of your testing. Therefore, a verification engineer needs to write stimulus, checker, and coverage components to verify a design under test. Next is what you need to learn to start your career in VLSI. Obviously, you need to learn Systemverilog. Apart from Systemverilog, if you are planning to be a design engineer, you need to be a master of digital design techniques. Even for an interview at graduate level, you can expect a lot of questions related to digital design. Now, for a beginner level verification engineer, it is good to be comfortable with some scripting languages like Perl or Python. And sometimes you can even expect some questions in C or C++ language at a graduate level interview. Next, we will see what will need to be learned in Systemverilog to be a design engineer and or a verification engineer. A design engineer needs to learn all the basics of Systemverilog and all the Systemverilog language features that is supported in Systemverilog for RTL design. Specifically, you need to be comfortable about the concept of different assignment statements like procedural assignment and continuous assignment, and also you need to be comfortable with Systemverilog design features like enumeration and interfaces, etc. Finally, even though it might not be a requirement for a graduate level engineer, after you start your career in Systemverilog design, it is important to be comfortable in writing assertions in Systemverilog. Therefore, you need to master Systemverilog assertion coding if you're planning to become a design engineer. Now, for a verification engineer, the verification engineer again need to be comfortable with all the basics of Systemverilog, or I would say they would be able to write simple Systemverilog design as well. They need to learn object-oriented programming concepts in Systemverilog, random constructs or constrained random constructs in Systemverilog, functional coverage coding in Systemverilog as well. Also, they need to learn a lot of assertion coding, even though they won't be writing a lot of assertions as many as designers write. But if you're planning to become a formal verification engineer, you have to be really comfortable in writing Systemverilog assertions. So finally, one of the most important things for a verification engineer to learn is the UVM, or the Universal Verification Methodology. So it is widely adopted in the industry, and I would say even for a graduate level verification position, it is good to be comfortable with UVM. Now the final question comes, how do I start learning Systemverilog? If you are somebody totally new to Systemverilog, here are some videos which you can go through to start learning Systemverilog. So before start learning Systemverilog, you need to be aware of the basics of the IC design process itself. Next, you can learn about how to write the first program in Systemverilog or the first module in Systemverilog, and followed by you can learn how to write a test bench for a simple design and also how to simulate your design. So first step is writing a simple Systemverilog design. Next is writing a simple Systemverilog test bench. And the third step is compiling and simulating your design and test bench together and seeing the results. So here is a link for the playlist in the I button and in the description below, which will list out these three videos. And if you're somebody new to Systemverilog, you can start learning from there. Nowadays, for compiling and simulating Systemverilog programs, you don't need a simulator. You can use the free online platforms, which is even allowing you to use the commercially available simulators for academic purpose. That's the end of this movie. I hope you have enjoyed the movie. Please subscribe us on YouTube. Also visit our website systemverilogacademy.com to find more Systemverilog courses and videos. Thank you for watching.